Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Well, isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord this morning? How many of you enjoyed service here last night? Did we take an incredible journey in the Word of the Lord last night? I'm telling you the truth, it was amazing, wasn't it, Brother Gene? I've determined Brother Donnie is a preaching doctor, and he's a doctor that preaches, and he's an astrologist, and the gift is from Almighty God. Aren't you glad for that this morning? Before we go into the service this morning, we want to make an announcement to you. There's a young man in the hospital this morning, Brother Doug McKinney. You remember Brother Doug McKinney that attended here? His grandson is in the hospital this morning, and it's a matter, his situation is a matter of life and death. Matter of fact, they said within the next 20 minutes that they would know if he was going to pull through or not. They've given him, I think, about 44 units of blood since 4 o'clock this morning. So we want to open this service with prayer this morning. I wonder if you'd stand with me. And we want to direct our focus, our attention right now to that young man. And there's another young man in the hospital that was involved in some things to do with that. He had to have his spleen removed, and he's got liver damage. And these boys, I think, were students over here at Happy Valley High School. So a lot of folks counting on somebody to touch in the Lord this morning. And I know if that was your child or your grandchild, the consideration and the despair that you'd be in this morning. So I wonder, Brother Gene, would you come this morning, and let's all just bow our heads and ask the will of the Lord to be done for these young men and for their families during this time, that God would just have mercy on them. Would you do that with us this morning, Brother Gene? God bless you.
Father, as we come before you this morning, it's not long ago, Father, that we put this boy's grandfather over here in the graveyard, and I knew then, Lord, that there was need to be some correcting in him. But Father, sometimes, Lord, we just go our own way. We do our own thing, Father. So this morning, though, God, we just know that you're a living God, and Lord, that you're able to reach your hand down for this young man today, God, and you can touch him, God, and may he have life, that he may straighten up his life, Lord, and serve you, Father, we pray, God. We don't know what may happen, God, tomorrow or today, Lord, but we know that you're a just God. And, Father, that you know all things this morning. And, God, you have sometimes a way, God, works out for your own glory, Father. So this morning we just pray, God, that you'll reach down your hand, Father, on this boy. He's in critical condition, God. I pray, God, that you'll reach down your hand, Father, and give him a chance, God, that he can live and maybe straighten his life up. God, that he may come to you, Father, and repent and live and go to church, God. I pray this morning, God, for him this morning. This congregation, Lord, is bowing their heads before you this morning. And our hearts are heavy this morning, God, for him, Father. We just pray now that you'll reach down, God. Touch him in a special way, God. May your will be done, Father, in everything that we do or say, God. I pray this morning for him. May you have your way this morning, God. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Touch him, Father, and let him be made whole once more, God, that he may turn his life around for you, God, we pray. We'll give you honor for it, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Father. Amen.
Grant it, Father. Amen. Thank you, Brother Gene. God bless you this morning. Why don't you turn around, shake somebody's hand, greet them in the name of the Lord, tell them you're glad to see them in church today. What a privilege it is to be in the house of the Lord. In Christ alone, I place my trust. Let's see if we can sing that this morning. Play a little bit of it while they fellowship. Yes, Lord. God bless you. Love you, buddy. Appreciate you. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Do the chorus. Christ alone I place my trust. Find my glory in the power of the cross. In every victory, let it be said of me, my source of strength, my source of hope is Christ alone. I place my trust and find my Let's look at our request this morning while you stand with me, if you will. Sister Deanna Glenn wants us to remember her twin brother David. He's having surgery on Monday for a very large kidney stone. He really appreciates her prayers, and for both of her parents not feeling well, in a lot of pain. So let's pray for those needs today. Sister Sylvia Barham says that she wants to thank everyone, and especially the Lord Jesus, for working out a custody situation for my 6 and 7 year old nephews. God answers their prayers. They have a new home for Christmas. God bless you all. We love you and can't wait to spend eternity with you all. Well, I think the feeling's mutual for all of us to be able to be together in eternity. Sister King wants to thank all of you for your prayers. She is so much better. Says, may God bless you. And Brother King also found his hearing aid. So praise the Lord for that. Praise the Lord. I want to remember Brother Terry Stockton in prayer this morning. The Lord would touch him. Brother Baker says that he was very sick last night. Before the service, several brothers prayed for him, and he was instantly healed, and he wants to praise the Lord for that. So somebody say, thank you, Jesus. I want to remember Brother James Miller. He's a message minister. I want to remember him in prayer this morning. He is from Missouri. He was on a missionary trip to Honduras and had a bad accident. He is in critical condition in a city there in that country. So we certainly want to pray for that need today, that the Lord would be mindful of that situation. Pray for Sister Anna Shipley's safety, traveling to her daughter on Wednesday. Praying for traveling mercy, so we'll commit that unto the Lord. Want to pray for a friend of ours. Well, this is actually the same request for a brother James Miller who was in that accident in Honduras. So we just commit these things unto the Lord. A lot of folks got sickness in their bodies, flu and different things. We want to commit them unto the Lord. And the little boys' names that we had Brother Gene pray over, Elijah McKinney and Nathan Fields, are the two little boys' names that's in the hospital this morning. I also want you to remember Carrie Yance. That's Brother Mark Yance and Kelly's little daughter. She's got a very, very serious skin problem. The doctors don't even know how to doctor, don't know what to do for her. And she's shedding layers and layers and layers of skins weekly. And just don't know what to do about it. So that's a child that needs somebody to care for it. And I know his mom and dad and grandparents and all the family is definitely concerned about her, but we want to be concerned about her too, that the Lord would just touch and heal her little body. All the unspoken prayer requests this morning, if you have something you'd like for this group to pray about, Brother Terry, why don't you come this morning? Let's invite the presence of our Lord into this service. God has got something wonderful in store for us again today. And let's ask God to move on behalf of all these needs today. Brother Terry, God bless you, buddy.
Let's join our faith together as we look to these requests in behalf. Heavenly Father, as we come to you, truly it's a joy to be back in the house of God. We're thankful that we can go to church this morning. Father, my heart goes back as Brother Gene was praying for this condition, for this young boy, critical. Whereas it says in the Bible that you repented because you'd even made man and violence had filled the land. Truly, the land today is to come to that place and even more violence is filling the land. It's been in the hearts of people to be evil because they have rejected God. But Lord, there's still a little people, a remnant upon the earth, that, truly that still love you and desire your God to serve you. As he prayed for the young boy, the accident he's in, God, we just want to continue to lift him up. Sister Deanna's request, you know all about it. We just commit that in your hands. We ask, Lord, that you'd help each one of us this morning, that we would take the message that was preached last night and apply it to our hearts, that we might be able to avoid many self-inflicted sicknesses and wounds and things of that nature that would that we'd bring upon ourselves. I pray, God, for these each one of these requests that I hold in my hand and bring to pass, Lord, the desired result. And may they be restored and lifted up. The minister brother down in Honduras, Lord, had an accident doing missionary work in critical condition. We bind that devil. Lord Jesus, may he be restored. May this brother be restored now, Lord, and brought back to health and back, Lord, to the States. Lord, his post of duty, I pray, in the line of duty and having an accident, help him, dear Jesus. Be with him. Administer your healing touch to him, dear Jesus, is our prayer. Every need, Lord, we all have needs. We have unsaved loved ones. People raise their hands. They have a need for family that needs to be brought in. We're at the last lap of the race, as it were. Lord, the fourth runner in the marathon is carrying the baton and just getting ready to break that rim, and we are that close, Lord, to the translation. Help us, Lord, to have a greater burden for those outside the ark of safety, that they may be brought in also. Those, Lord, that may be waning, Lord, we pray for them. Those that are on the verge of depression, we pray for them. God, ever need, we ask that you would meet each one. Give us grace. Anoint our brother to speak this morning. Lord, give him the ever-present water from the rock, Lord, to be able to shine upon our lives that we in a thirsty land might drink once more, we pray this morning. Grant these things, Lord. We love you and we appreciate you. We ask these in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. We're so glad to have you in the service today. If you're visiting with us, we certainly want to welcome you to the service. Those that are streaming this service today, may God richly bless all of our streaming brothers and sisters as well. Let me make a couple of announcements. Sister Cinda, Sister Anna's CD is available for you over in the library if you'd like to pick one of those up. And also, all adult sisters, please pick up a booklet in the library. All adult sisters, go by the library. They have a booklet for you over there today. And if you would, go by and pick that up. And also, I'll request your prayer last night for Brother Tracy Brizendine again. And about 6:45 tonight, about 6:45, out at the Quillen Rehab, we're going to gather out there and sing him some songs. Anybody wants to go, you're welcome. If you can't, we understand, but just want to make that available. Brother Tracy is seeking visitors, and he loves company. He's here down in Tennessee. We're the only family he's got. So if you can go, you're welcome to come in, and we're going to sing some songs out there at the nursing home tonight. Now, your name won't be in the paper tomorrow. And it won't make WJHL TV or ever who they have it on, but it's a great way to do something for somebody that needs help. Is that right? A lot of folks always say, "Well, I'd really like to do something for the Lord." Well, there's all kinds of opportunities. You just gotta go get them and do them. Let's sing a song this morning. Somebody say, "Praise the Lord." Somebody say, "I'm glad to be in church." Look at somebody and say, "Are you glad too?" Now give the Lord a big hand clap of praise if you love him this morning. There's a happy land of promise over in the great beyond, where the saved of earth shall soon the glory share, where the souls of men shall live and live on forevermore. Everybody will be happy over there. And believe it with all your heart? Do you believe it with all your heart? There we'll meet the one who saved us and who's kept us by his grace and who's brought us to that land so bright and fair. We're gonna praise his name forever as we look upon that precious, precious face. Everybody, oh, you're gonna be happy. You're gonna really be happy over there. I know everybody. A good hand clap of praise. How great thou art. How great thou art. Amen. Let's sing this song in praise and honor to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Around the world this time of year, everybody's got a baby in a manger. But I'm glad it's not just a baby in a manger that we look at today, but it's a king on a throne, on the throne of our heart. That's where I want him to be, in my heart. Is that your desire this morning? Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me. I'll pray I'm not afraid to die.
today. Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lord. Blessed be the Lord. Amen. God bless you. I'm going to let you be seated this morning. You're singing. You're just singing so good. Before we have a couple of songs this morning, Sister Sarah, if you'd come, be getting ready. Brother Andrew Stutzman has a song for us today. If he would come, also the platform, be getting ready. I want to give you just a brief testimony about a little nursing home experience that Brother Kenneth, Brother Lindy, and myself had about 3 weeks ago on a Monday night. We were over here at Ivy Hall singing a few songs for my sister. It kept getting more people, so we moved it down to the break room. And there may be 12 to 15 people. And, you know, Brother Bram said, you'll be totally insane and still have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And I just thought, we were there singing, and those old folks, they probably couldn't tell you what they had for lunch an hour or supper an hour ago, but they can remember words to them old songs just like it was yesterday. Amen. And we were singing Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Those older folks were just joining in and raising their hands and praising the Lord. And there was a man sitting over in a wheelchair. Brother Terry's all just bent over. He looked just really, just like he was there, but he wasn't. You know what I'm saying? And there was a woman sitting beside him, and she looked a lot younger than him, but they were both the same age. And it was the man's wife. He'd had Alzheimer's, and he'd had it, she told us, for about 14 years. And he would just sit in there. And we got to we sung Amazing Grace. Then we come to the part, praise God, praise God. And that little old fella lifted his hands and started praising the Lord. And his wife, her mouth fell open. She said, he don't even know who I am. But he knew the words and knew how to praise the Lord. I just thought, you know, you go somewhere to try to help somebody and they end up helping you. I had to quit singing. I was crying like a baby, and they probably thought, we're going to put you in here next, buddy. But I'm just telling you what the Lord can do for people, and they be out of their mind naturally, but God's got something great in store for God's people. I believe that with all of my heart. Don't know what kind of shape we're going to get in here, but I know we got a new body we're headed to. Aren't you glad about that this morning? Give the Lord one more hand clap of praise as our singers sing for us.
From strength to strength, we sometimes go. Then again, we're sinking low in the shadow of a mountain looming high above our head. We need not fear what lies ahead, for the Word has clearly said that faith would be sufficient to make the mountain disappear. So speak to the mountain, you'll not try. In the midst of the battle, when the foe is gaining ground, just look up and you'll see the mighty hand of God. It's reaching down. You speak God's name and Satan trembles. You speak God's word and watch him flee. For once again, my God delivers, and the mouth.
It's not home where men sell their souls, and the taste of power is sweet. Where wrong is right, neighbors fight, while the hungry are dying in the streets. Where kids are abused, and women are used, and the weak are crushed by the strong. The nation's gone bad, Jesus is sad, and I don't belong. I don't belong, and I'm going someday home to my own native land. I don't belong, and it seems like I hear the sound of a welcome home band. I don't belong, I'm a foreigner here, singing a sojourner's song. And I've always known that this place ain't home, and I don't belong. Don't belong. But while I'm here, I'll be living like I've nothing to lose. And while I breathe, I'll just believe my Lord is gonna see me through. I'll not be deceived by earth's make-believe, and I'll close my ears to her siren song. By praising his name, and I'm not ashamed, 'cause I don't belong. But I belong to a kingdom of peace, where only love is the law, where children lead and captives are free, and God becomes a baby on the straw, where dead men live and rich men give their kingdoms to buy back a song, and where sinners like me become royalty and will all belong. Yes, I belong, and I'm going someday home to my own native land, where I'll belong. And it seems like I hear the sound of a welcome home band. Yes, I belong, not a foreigner there, singing a sojourner's song. Oh, I've always known that I'm going home where I belong. Yes, I've always known that this place ain't home, and I don't belong.
Praise the Lord. Certainly appreciate our songs this morning. A couple of announcements. Ushers, if you'll come this morning, receive the morning tithe and offering. Could we stand together?
If you haven't gone by the library this morning, or as of yet, to get your Christmas card from Brother Donnie and Sister Carol and the family, they have those available for you over in the library this morning, your Christmas card. So please go by and pick those up if you haven't yet. You give us unto the Lord. Let's sing a little chorus together as our pastor gets ready to come and bring us the word of the Lord today. I'm glad for one thing. God's got it all in control. He's got it all in control. He's got it all in control.
Got it all in control. He's got it all. Today, if you would. Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to you today that we do believe that the things that lay before us, our future, our destiny, it is not based upon politics. It is not based upon people. We're so grateful it's not even based upon us. If it was based upon me, where would I wind up going? What would I wind up being? But we're so grateful, Father, that you have a plan for our lives. As I heard your prophet said the other day, that we come to this earth by the will of God, and we will leave the same way. I pray as we endeavor to look into your word today, that you would help us to see, Lord, that in this great plan of God, there's so many things that can affect our lives. It doesn't mean that every step in this journey that you have predetermined that we would walk in a way of defeat or sickness or trouble. But help us to see the outcome, the destiny will definitely be absolutely according to your plan. But there's many things between point A and point B that can be affected by us. Help us, I pray, Lord. Speak to us today from your word, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. And we can say it's good to be in the house of the Lord today. Let's read from Philippians chapter 4 again today, if you would. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. I'd like to speak to you today on capturing our thoughts. Capturing our thoughts. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, which means don't worry about anything. But in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. How many believes there's value in that?
Amen.
How many believes it's the Word of God?
Amen.
God bless you. You may be seated. Then if indeed we believe it is the Word of God, then there's a value, as you said, that you believed and agreed that there was to it. There's something there that word truly holds something for each of us as Christians. We know that simply accepting the word from a mental standpoint can do wonderful things in many people's lives. Many people can be able to take the word, even the financial aspect. One reason that many of the television preachers and a lot of these people are able to just get the blessing side and all that sort of thing, it's a law of God. And that law of God is not just for the bride. You see, whenever the law of God was made for the universe, the law of God was made for botany life, for animal life, it was made for many things of God. The Bible tells us that the rain falls on the just and the unjust. That's the law of God. The bride's not the only one that gets benefit of sunshine. The bride's not the only one that gets benefit of the atmosphere, the nitrogen, the oxygen, all that sort of thing. Every living human being on the face of the earth, and if there's something physically wrong with them, gets benefits from the oxygen and the atmosphere that God created thousands of years ago. And that exactly applies in the spiritual sense, that many people can take certain things in the Word. They may emphasize totally on healing and miracles and blessings and all this abundant type of thing, but yet there is a law to that promise of God, and they will apply it. They'll look like whores. They'll paint up like Jezebels. Live right. They won't live right a bit more than nothing, but yet they'll be able to tap into that law of God, and they'll make it work. And there'll be people who live a lot better life that simply don't have the understanding to that law, but they feel like God owes it to them. Now you see, when we get our mindset that God owes us anything, we're already in trouble. But whenever we can approach it from the aspect, He owes me absolutely nothing whatsoever, but that he will give it to me based upon my law, my faith in His law of understanding that faith. But I'm afraid many times that around this message, many people approach the promises of God with this thing that God owes it to me because I'm bride. He owes you absolutely nothing. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. But if we approach it in the very same way that we approach any other promise of God, through the principle of faith and having an understanding that God will bring to pass His own word, then God will do that. But if we approach it that somehow on our persona or something that we are, well, I'm the bride, and God absolutely owes it to me on that basis. He will never give us anything on any basis other than His word. So whenever we look at the promises of God, and I know down through the years it stumbles so many people because they look and say, well, my, this person got a prayer answered in that one and that one. They don't even believe the message. They don't have to. They don't have to believe the message to believe that God can save a sinner. They don't have to believe the message to believe by His stripes are healed. They believe the Bible by believing that. And therefore, they can approach that on that simple basis. Well, Jesus was stripes so I could be healed. Never heard the name William Branham. Never went to a Message church to get healed. And you might sit here today, have all kinds of sicknesses in your body and all kinds of affliction. But you approach it because I'm in the message. You might as well be in a hog pen if that's the way you're going to approach it. God don't give you nothing. Now, I'll let you sit here and wonder if I've got quotes on that to back it up or not. Now, I want you to think now, if our thoughts do need to be captured, why would they need to be captured? If you and I have been given a charge by the Spirit of God that we are to capture our thoughts, why would they need to be captured? If they're all pure, of divine origin, if they are holy, if they are harmless, if there are things that will benefit us in every way, then why would our thoughts need to be captured? Well, you and I both know that all of our thoughts are not pure. All of our thoughts are not of divine origin. All of our thoughts are not beneficial to us.
but many of the thoughts that come to the minds of children of God. Now, it does not mean that they originate from heaven. It does not even mean they originate from you. But because your mind is accessible to both divine power and evil power, they both have the capability of projecting thoughts into your mind. Also, you have the capability of projecting thoughts and thinking thoughts from you that are not really even from God or from the devil. They're just from you. That's right. So they lay there buried in the subconscious, or because of things that you think about, things that you thought since you were a child, many things that we hold on to and that we believe, whether by false teaching, by error, or whatever more, many of those things are still embedded in us to this day. Many of our actions that come from a subliminal action in our life, you don't even think about it, you don't even premeditate it, but it's something that's stored deep within you, and it becomes an action that is so done you don't have to think about it anymore. Wouldn't it be something if faith could be that way to us? That faith would be so rooted in our lives, and you say, can it be? The prophet says it can be. That it will become just as real to us as putting the keys in our ignition to come to church or go to Walmart or go to work. Now, but there must be things by which that we approach it in the right way. Would it all be divinely done by God? It will not. Will God supernaturally replace all the thoughts in my mind that are contrary to His word? He will not. There are certain things that God tells you and I to do, and if we don't do our part, then it will limit and prohibit what God can do on the supernatural part. Watch this in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee. Amen. How many would like to have perfect peace? Here's a very simple application. You got to keep your mind stayed on the Lord, though. Uh-oh. So that means leaving off worries? That means leaving off a bunch of carnality, a bunch of nonsense? This is why we don't have it. Because we're not willing to do our part. Now watch. Thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed. Now look at this word, very, very simple. Stayed, which means rest, lean against, to support, oppose, sustain, refresh, revive. So thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is leaned against or supported or upheld or sustained or revived upon the Lord, because he trusteth in thee. Now if this was so in the Old Testament without a new birth, how much more is this capable of being brought to pass in our lives today once our souls have become regenerated by the power of God? Now, notice Jesus in Matthew chapter 15, 17. Do you not yet understand that whatsoever entereth in at the mouth goeth into the belly and is cast out into the draw? But those things which proceed out of the mouth. Now remember, they're coming from Judaism. They're coming from the Mosaic laws. Thou shalt not eat this. Thou shalt not eat that. And Jesus is introducing a new covenant. Imagine how difficult it was. You'd been raised all of your life not to eat things web-footed. You'd been raised all of your life not to eat shrimp, calamari. You'd not been raised not to eat all kinds of things, a hog and whatever more. You couldn't even sow linen and woolen on the same garden. You couldn't even mix up your garden with two different types of seed. So Jesus is coming now to introduce an entire way. So they watch a new way. Every bite they put into their mouth, they watched it. It had to be clean. It had to be of a certain way. You could not drink goat's milk and then eat it with lamb meat. You had to eat your bread a certain way. You had to mix your vegetables a certain way. And now Jesus has come to them and said, look, it's no longer imperative that what goes into your belly so much is the value, but it's what comes not goes in your mouth, but what comes out of your mouth. Now it took him years and years. Remember, Jesus had to show Peter a vision whenever he let down a big sheep and he saw all these things of beasts that was unclean. And he said, arise, Peter. And he said, not so. I've never eaten anything like that in my life. It took years to get it out of him. Which makes me hopeful for me and you. Oh, glory. I said it makes it hopeful for me and you. Now you realize then that slowly and gradually he began to take this out of them, and your Jesus is giving them principles of the New Testament basis, that it's not so much that a man eating a goat or a man eating a pig or a man eating a shrimp or whatever more, that's not what defiles the man, but it's actually what comes out of the man's mouth, which comes from the man's heart. Now watch this. So is it this muscle here in your chest? Bump, 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 bump. Is that the heart? Cardia? No, that's not what he's talking about. Now watch, he says, but those things which proceed out of the mouth cometh forth from the heart, and they defile the man. Now this is a total new concept to them. Because to them, everything on the outside, it was a world. To the Jewish law, there was nothing spiritual. It was all natural. It's what you touched. It's what you felt. It's what you looked at. So many steps that you took to go into the presence of God. Your red band of blue along the bottom, everything was totally, completely natural to them. Now they're breaking into a supernatural world that they understand absolutely nothing about. So you imagine his words were so peculiar, and he tried to begin to break forth. Now remember, he's working on apostles that are bound up in tradition, just like all the rest of the elders are. So he says, out of the heart proceed evil thoughts. How is that possible? How can thoughts come from the heart? In the heart a muscle? Now you imagine them looking at Jesus, about like some of y'all looking at me and say, what is he going to say? What in the world can he mean by that? Thoughts come out of the heart? Notice, out of the heart proceedeth evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. Now he's going to change them from just taking these things on the outside and sanctifying everything. Remember, they would not even sit down and eat a meal until they washed their hands from the tips of their fingers to their elbows. Some of them were so legal, they would not sit down and eat lunch until they went in and changed their turban. They changed all of their clothes just in case dust from a Gentile got on them when they was at the market. And they were as lost as they could be. So here Jesus now focuses and said, don't you understand? What defiles you is from what's within you. Do you understand, sisters? Your hair can be just right. Your length of your sleeves can be so right. Your dresses can be so right. And you can be as wretched and vile from your heart and black as black can be. Notice again in Luke chapter 12, verse 28. If then God so clothe the grass, which today is in the field, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more would it clothe you, O ye of little faith? And seek ye not what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, neither be ye of a doubtful. How come he didn't say heart? Look at this word doubtful, what it means. By metaphor, taking from ships that are tossed about on the deep by winds and waves. To cause one to waver or fluctuate in the mind. So they believe the message until they can't answer a certain question. And then they're tossed about and they go over on this side of the lake. And then the wind carries them over on this side of the lake. And Jesus said, don't be of a tossed about mind, but bring your thoughts into captivity. Capture every thought that is contrary to the word of God. Now I realize I'm preaching something that's totally impossible to the natural man, but hopefully I'm preaching to people that are more than natural men and women today. Now watch this, as Paul writes this in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity. captivity every thought. Is there anybody here that believes this is possible? What do the rest of y'all believe? Is there anybody here that believes this is possible? You're the ones it'll happen to. Now watch this. Bringing into captivity. Look at the meaning of the word. To lead away captive. To capture one's mind. Why do we need to worry about the mind if the soul has already got the Holy Ghost? Because the soul is not where the greatest battle that ever fought's going on. Do you understand? If you got the Holy Ghost, there is no battle in the soul. There is no battle around the seal, but there can be a battle in your mind. Now, let's go back into the, let's just try to merge if God will help us. We want to approach it from the scripture, from the message, and from medical science. Now, you realize that God doesn't really have to explain why he says things. He just says them and he wants us to believe them. But many times it helps us to understand the wherefores and the whys whenever we're able to look at it from a spiritual perspective and also a natural perspective as well. Now, let me read this to you, and I wanted to make these available, and Brother Michael told me some of them may not be there, but maybe they will be. They'll be on the website, so you can go back and look at them later. Our thoughts and emotions are represented in the body as electrochemical reactions. These chemicals are constantly floating around in our bodies, are stored in different places. The research is clear that negative thoughts and the associated harmful chemicals have detrimental effects on your health. Y'all believe this? See if you believe this. You can control the degree to which harmful chemicals float around your body by adjusting your thinking patterns. Well, glory. Man, I might be feeling 20 years old in a month from now. That's where I'm headed inevitably, for sure. Whether by here or by here, I'm headed that way. Now notice this in blind Bartimaeus. Brother Ben said, when you get to thinking about divine healing, get to thinking about Christ, keep him on your mind. If there be any praise, if there be any virtue, the Bible says, think on these things. If any thought comes by, well, maybe it couldn't be so. Maybe get it off your mind right quick. Think on things that's... You don't mean to tell me Brother Branham was a positive thinking preacher. Now, not the New Age type. Not of this last day. This is the true positive thinking. Glory. Notice, think on things that's positive. Never let a negative thought pass through. And then if it does, don't let it stop anyhow, he says. If it starts to, keep your thoughts positive. How many needs help with this morning? I want every person in here to have this in your mind. As soon as the prayer begins for the sick, every one of you is going to get up and walk out of the building well. Oh, is Brother Bram now teaching a little mind over matter? So as soon as the prayer line started, he wanted them to get in their mind, I'm going to walk out of here well. Brother Bram more than likely didn't know, wasn't even known to science, probably didn't know all the chemicals, all the different things that was released in the natural anatomy of man by thinking negative thoughts, but he understood the spiritual principle of God. Paul might not have known all the neuroneptides. Paul might not have understood all the different things that science has broke into today, but he understood inspiration from God. That as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Oh, my. Now, watch this. I want every person in here to have this in your mind. As soon as the prayer begins to go for the sick, I want every one of you, oh, my, every one of you is going to get up and walk out of the building well. Don't have nothing else in your mind. Keep thinking that. Now, wait a minute. I thought all we needed, the only avenue, was believing. Just believe, 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 believe. Do you understand you can believe right and still not think right? Well, I know God's a healer. I know God's a savior. I know God can do this, but will he do it for you? Well, I don't know about it. So you're believing right, but you're not thinking right. You're not thinking that for you personally, it's become identified. So what are you doing? Quoting Logos. Now, this is the reason why. Look at this simple statement. Don't have nothing else in your mind. Keep thinking that. If there be any praise, any virtue, think on these things. You cannot get anything from God with a negative thought. It's not mind over matter, it's word over matter. That's what God used in the beginning, word over matter, and brought matter into existence. Now, you can think all you want to that y'all's going to be millionaires, but I'm going to tell you before you think it, more than likely, you're wasting your time. Because God knows most of us ain't got enough sense to be a millionaire. So if I was you, I'd think about things that's more realistic than old dumb stuff. I'm going to have a whole fleet of Cadillacs. No, you ain't. I'm going to live in a 21,000 square foot house. I doubt it here or there. Think realistic according to the word, according to the things that will benefit you as a child of God. Watch this again. He says, 1956. Don't think that kind of a negative thought. Don't let it go to your mind. Make every word positive and every You know, the disciples, after the resurrection of Jesus, Cleophas and his friend, was on his road to down to Emmaus, and as he went around talking about Jesus, thinking about Jesus, he stepped right out of the bushes and walked with them while they were thinking on him, while they were meditating. That's the same way Jesus does today. In my heart, on my mind, all day long, let me walk with the Lord in the light of his word. With the heavenly dove, let me have fellowship all day long. Oh, thank God. Are you believing with me that that's attainable? Sure. And you know, it's usually when we're thinking about God and keeping our minds on God that God comes close to us. I think that's one of the great troubles of the people of this day. We got too many other things on our You mean I can love him with all of my heart? I can love him with all of my heart, but I don't never think about him. I just think about this and that and the other. And I think about his work. And I think about his people. And I think about his church. And I think about his message. And I think about his prophet. But I don't think about him. I don't want just a personal relationship with you all. I like you all, but y'all didn't save me. Y'all are all right. And I want to spend an eternity with you. But I don't want to worship you. Okay? I like being around you, but I want to be around him. He's the reason. Notice this now, how simple that the negative can project itself so close to the positive. Now watch Satan, how sly he is. I think it's one of the great troubles of the people of this day. We have too many other things in our mind. Even when we come to a healing service, we seem to think, well, I did not get a prayer card tonight. Now look at this negative thought. It's not. That man's a false prophet. God's not a healer. God's a liar. Just a simple thought. I never got a prayer card. Now watch. Well, I did not get a prayer card tonight. Or perhaps I'll not be prayed for. We'll never be able to accomplish much as long as we keep these kind of thoughts. You mean a thought like that is harmful? A thought like that can hinder me from receiving from God? I'm not saying there ain't no God. I'm not saying he's dead. I'm not saying that he can't move. I'm just saying he might or might not move for me today. So I go to church and I get that in my mind. Oh, that ain't the direction I want, Brother Don. I go, that's not my needs. That's not, oh God, I ain't gonna get nothing. And you sit right there with that negative thought the rest of the entire service. And God may have had me to study this out for you. But in your minds, you perceived it the wrong way from the beginning. And you sat there the rest of the service shut down on me. Oh my goodness. We'll never be able to accomplish much as long as we keep those kind of thoughts. Let's be positive in our thinking. Notice this. What is the Holy Ghost? 1959. The other night, a little around after midnight, the wife and I, after sitting up praying, talking to the Lord, across a little footstool in our front room, two open Bibles. We consecrated ourselves anew to God for a complete service, that we would surrender our own wills. You mean to tell me this is 1959, the Holy Ghost series? Brother Bram has been preaching all these years. He's been casting out devils, had visions, had a walk with God, had more supernatural in his ministry than any mortal man that's ever walked on the earth. And now he wants to give all of his will. Don't you understand, friends? This is an ongoing process. You don't do it once. You do it again and again and again and again. Had he not done all these things, genuine, sure he had. But he had reached another turning point in his life. You ever reach there? When you reach a spot in your life that you have to reevaluate where you are. You've got to look at your age. You've got to look at your strength. You've got to look at your talent and say, God, help me to reevaluate where I am. Now watch, Brother Branham is at this spot. I love the way he does this. So he reevaluates himself in the living room. Him and his wife are knelt down at a footstool in the front room, which is Kentuckian for living room. I'll interpret in case you fancy fang-dangle people don't know what that means. The front room is the living room. Brother Bam wasn't in church. He was not in Sabino Canyon. But he was in the front room. He's on one side of the footstool. His wife is on the other. She don't have a better homes and gardens opened up than him an outdoor life. But they have two open Bibles. I like that symbolism. Open Bibles produce open hearts. Now notice, in our front room with two open Bibles, we consecrated ourselves, not for the first time, but anew. Anew. To God for a complete service, that we would surrender our own wills and everything. Brother Branham, what else are you going to give him? Every negative Amen. Thought. Amen. Now what's amazing is he does this in this phase in his life. He's at this phase in 1959. He comes at another phase similar to this in 1960. Another one similar in 1962. before the seals can come open, he comes to another one of these phases in his life in 1963. And the Lord tells him, go consecrate yourself for the visitation of the angels. Why is it we don't hear this talked about in the message much? Oh, here's just the doctrine. What about the consecration? Then reconsecrate. No, friend, that's where many of us are today. It's not that you need to get saved again. You don't need the Holy Ghost again. You just to renew your consecration before God. So you're consecrating your will. You're consecrating your motive and committing your negative thoughts. As me and Carol got in our vehicle last night and I told her as we pulled out over the hill here, I said, in light of this that we've heard preached tonight, I want you and I, by God's grace, to move into a realm to lay aside so much negative stuff. We have to talk about sickness. We have to talk about people's troubles. We have to talk about things, but there's a place you can talk about it, and then there's a place to stop. Because then it will become your testimony if you're not careful. Now watch this. He says, I took my wife back there by the hand, crossed this Bible, her little Bible, and I said, honey, I've been too worldly. I've been drinking. I've been running around. I've been too negative. Wonder how many of us, you don't have to raise your hands, but I wonder from your heart, if the Holy Ghost today would convict you for being so negative, so sarcastic, nothing good to say about nobody, and it stems from yourself. But you blame it on everybody else. You show me people that can trust nobody, I'll show you where the trust factor lays within them. Well, I didn't figure you'd say amen. It's a truth anyhow. I can preach with them or without them. Now watch this, honey. I've been too negative. Listen to this. The Holy Spirit condemns me for being negative. For running around, flirting with somebody else's wife. For drinking, for smoking. We could relate, but for being negative? The Holy Ghost convicted Brother Branham for being negative. I said, I think of them squirrels out yonder. I think of Hattie Wright back there and them little boys. I think of what God did, showing that he was God, that he could create. Hallelujah. I thought he told me that years ago, I'll not leave you, I'll never forsake you. No man will stand before you all the days of your life. What's Brother Branham doing? Comparing now the positives. Comparing the positives. Which he should have done before this. And then the Holy Ghost wouldn't have condemned him. Jesus, would you care if Gabriel would amen me? Because I don't think they're going to today. Now, for those of us that develop all of this negative sarcasm and all this, you know why? We've forgotten so many of the positive things he's done in our lives. If he never answers another prayer for you, my brother, sister, he's done more than you deserve. If he never lets you feel him again, if he never comes down and moves for your children, if he never meets another need your entire life, he's done way more than we all deserve. Notice this. Lord Jesus, and from this hand of discernment, it'll come. I'll let you know the secret of the heart. After that, I'll raise you higher and higher. And year after year, he said, that proved the perfect world around. Here comes this other greater ministry far beyond that. I said, honey, I take your hand. By God's help and God's grace, never let me be negative again. Amen. You got to be kidding me. He took his wife's hand and said, by God's grace and by God's help, and asking her to help him not be negative again. That's a real man. Can you imagine a man so great that he would do it in his front room and then get up and tell thousands of people that's going to hear these tapes? I asked my wife to help me not to be negative no more. Now, some of you Charles Atlas brothers, that don't fit your machoism, does it? You little wimp. You little coward. Oh, my goodness. By God's help and God's grace, never let me be negative again. Let me walk forth to this revival here to preach like never before. Let me go here to first sanctify myself and make a way for the people. Oh, glory to God. That my own sins, my own neglecting be under the blood. My own shortcomings be under the blood. Notice this. Then what will he do? He said that I may walk out and say, follow me, people. I can follow a man like that. A man that's so big that can never give his wife a kind word, I got no confidence in him. A man that's too spiritual to do honeydews around the house, I wouldn't give you a nickel for him. He's too deep to love his family, too deep to love his wife. He don't even understand the love of God. Why didn't Brother Bam call T.L. Osborne? Why didn't Brother Bam call W.F. Grant? Said, meet me down at the tabernacle. Let's do this right. It was very fitting who he knelt across in front of. His helpmeet. And then some of you sorry men in this message, make your wife walk behind you, treat her like she's a dog. You're the dog. You got a daughter of God for a wife, you need to treat her like a queen. Well, praise the Lord. Gonna keep on, Jesus. You're gonna get me fired from here one of these days. Follow me, people. That's right. I hate to see a guy say, you go do it. I like to see somebody that'll lead the way. Don't you see what he's doing, Brother Jim? A man that can say, I have been so negative. Now, don't get mad at me and don't fall out with me. But Brother Branham battled this, being negative. And this wasn't the end of it. It's going to come around again and again and again. Come on, children. This wasn't the end of it. Oh, glory to God, this is the end of it. Oh, no. Standing in the gap, he's ready to go right through the same thing again. But he does not let it get the best of him. He does not stop and say, well, I might as well quit. But he gets up and wipes himself over and says, here I go. Y'all want to go with me? Come on. Glory. What's this? Look how powerful now your words are. How many is Christians? Perhaps 95%, maybe 100. Raise up your hands, a Christian. As long as you believe that, all right. But the minute that you begin to think that you're not believe that you're not, but think that you're not. Lord, transform our thinking. That's the time you start sinking right there. It might happen in your living room. It might happen driving down the road. It might happen sitting in a service and Satan will put that in your mind. You're not really a Christian. Can't bother you at all until you begin to think it. You don't even believe it's the truth. But you entertain that thought. I might not be a Christian. Maybe I'm not. Maybe I'm deceiving myself. If you do not eradicate that thought and capture it, that thought will capture you. It will bring you into such captivity, you won't even feel saved no more. Oh my. The minute you begin to think you're not, that's the time you start sinking right there. That's the time your testimony is negative. Divine healing lasts as long as your faith lasts. Your salvation, the same. Oh my goodness. Because everything of God is by faith, and nothing of God can be proven by natural. Gonna go on a bit. Well, our thoughts are always negative. We come in a prayer line. I notice we come in a prayer line. Oh, if he'll tell me. If he'll tell me. Lord, you know, I'm glad some of y'all didn't live, Brother Bram say. The way y'all come up to me for prayer over and over again, you'll kill the poor man. I'm here to pray for him. I'm here to do everything I can. But many times you're weakening your own faith. But Brother Donnie, I didn't feel it. You don't need a feeling. You need faith. Watch, the people was looking for what when Brother Bram was here? Discernment. Tell me my name. Oh, you don't know your name? Tell me where I live. Well, I can understand if you have some kind of illness, you should remember where you live. But why do you need faith to tell you where you live? Watch it in the discernment line. When Brother Branham will call the people out, man, their faith will escalate. And then he'll rest himself. God bless you, brother. God bless you, sister. Now he said, he's still here. He's still here. What was happening? Their faith was going down. Then he started again. Well, you're so-and-so, you're so-and-so, and so-and-so. Man, here it would come again. Oh my, you never get nothing like that. You're so negative to begin with. Come to the fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, where sinners plunge beneath the flood and lose all their guilty stains. That's it. Come with faith, believing. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. The thing to do is just say and make up your mind that it's God. And God said so, and I'm going to meet his requirement, and that settles it forever. Well, wait a minute, I thought it was believe. Well, just believe and believe and believe and believe. But if your mind is not made up with your believing, you still won't get it. Or you can get it and lose it. Now watch, Brother Branham stands before a congregation in Chicago in 1961. Repeat after me. Congregation repeats after Brother Branham. Lord, I believe that you're the Son of God. I renounce my unbelief. Oh, that gets some of us because we don't think we got none. Could y'all repeat this prayer after Brother Branham? Or would your message pride sat there and hindered? Bless God, I'll tell you one thing. That's why I can't help you. That's why I can't help you. I renounce my unbelief. I accept you as my Savior. I accept you as my healer. I accept you as my King. I believe you. Now, Lord, from henceforth, my testimony shall never be negative. God help me. God help me. God help them. God help them. God help them. God help them. Influence in New York. If you'll set your mind and eyes and motives and objectives in life on the right thing, you've got to come out on the right thing. Hold on. You can't fail. But remember, it must be inclusive. Your mind, your eyes, your motives, it cannot. I believe. You can, I believe all you want to and fail miserably. Now let's change the page a little bit. Let's look at the science that scientists begin to understand the last 10, 15, 20 years, however long it's been, called neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity. It means that our thoughts can change the structure and function of our brains. The idea was first introduced by William James in 1890, but soundly rejected by the denomination, by scientists, who uniformly believe that the brain is rigidly mapped out with certain parts of the brain controlling certain functions. If that part is dead or damaged, the function is altered or lost. Well, it appears they were wrong. So neuroplasticity now enjoys wide acceptance as scientists are proving the brain is endlessly adaptable and dynamic. It has power to change its own structure. So if thoughts can change my brain, can't God thoughts change my body? Lord. Notice this. Even for those with severe neurological afflictions, people with problems like strokes, cerebral palsy, mental illness, can train other areas of their brains through repetitive mental and physical activities. It is completely life-altering. Now think of it when many of you my age were younger. Did you ever hear of therapy? People had a stroke, they sent them home paralyzed, right? How come now we've got something called therapy? They have a heart procedure, they send them to therapy. They have a weakness in the body, they send them to therapy. Why? They have broken into an understanding that if there's a part of your brain that is dead and the motor skills are lost, they can retrain your brain. It's very painful. I sat in the hospital with some of our saints and sat through therapy with some of them and hear them scream as the therapist would make them move a foot or move a leg or move a knee because the brain says no. But through pain and difficulty, they retrained that brain. And a man that went in there like this that can't even move, they retrain him and he's able to come out and wave his hand. Oh, glory to God. If that's so unnatural, what about the supernatural power of God? As Eliana, one of Lance and Erica's little girls, still takes therapy, and I take her sometimes on Thursdays. I sat there at that place a few weeks ago. You see all kinds of poor little pitiful kids come in there. Some of them can't walk, some of them can't talk, and they'll take them back in and do the therapy, and then they'll bring them out and show the parents or the grandparents what they've been able to accomplish. My heart just about broke. A little bitty old girl about this big comes out, and her accomplishment for that day was she was able to reach down and pick up a ball and hand it to her mama. Now to me and you, that might not be a great thing, but to her, it was through agony, through pain, through distress. But those therapists had been able to send a message to her praying, we are not going to accept this paralysis. We are not going to accept this head. We want you to work with us. Y'all didn't know that I was a therapist, did you? Every time you come to church, I'm giving you therapy. Heavenly therapy. Oh, glory to God. You said,
I can't do it. I can't do it. I'm saying, you can do it. We can overcome. We can live this word. We can be what God wants us to be. And at the end of the service, you say, glory, hallelujah. And I look back at you and say, glory to God, they got it. Watch this. It means that repetitive positive thought and positive activity can rewire your brain and strengthen brain areas that stimulate positive feelings. You said, Brother Donnie, when all this is said and done, all these big fandango words you've been using, what's it going? What's the bottom line for me? Make you a little more happy. A little more pleasant. A little more in possession of what's yours as a child of God. Get rid of that droopy, stinking old frown many of y'all have on your face from the time I start to the time I get done, and turn that thing upside down and put a smile on your face. I almost think we need to have smile therapy in the message. I think some of y'all have forgot how to smile. You have let this world and your travels rob you. Watch this. Dr. Norman Deutsch, MD, states plainly that the brain has the capacity to rewire itself and or form new neutral pathways if we... Uh-oh. So you want to go to therapy and say, abracadabra, abracadoo, I'll make a new person out of you. So if you want a new brain, you're going to have to work. Okay, Brother Ryan, tell me what I got to do. Can you get it done by 12? No, it's already 12:30. Can you fix me up in 5 minutes? No. As a matter of fact, they say it takes 66 days for you to reprocess a negativism that you've accepted all of your life, that your daddy told you, or your mama, or your grandpa, that you're no good, you'll never amount to nothing. But you see, one of the wrong things many of us have done most of our life is we combat those negative thoughts, which is not what you want to do. You want to replace them. Make them unemployed. Well, glory to God. Who knows? We may have church before this is over after all. Now watch this. Have the ability to rewire or form new natural pathways if we do the work like exercise. The work requires repetition and activity to reinforce new learning. Neuroplasticity not only applies to actions, but to thoughts as well. There are two types of plasticity: positive plasticity and negative plasticity. As you can guess, positive plasticity is connected to positive changes in the brain. Repetitive positive thought and positive activity can rewire your brain and strengthen, my Lord, areas that stimulate positive things, feelings, emotions. Who knows? Some of y'all might even clap your hands. Lord, wouldn't that be something? Our patterns of thought and how we view our life can contribute to a powerful trait called adaptive competence. In a recent NPR segment, commentator, and whatever this guy is, Dr. Mark Longs described adaptive competence as our ability to bounce back from stress. Now, I'm not sure who here would ever need that, but if you ever need it, you'll know what it is. Whew. Man, I'll tell you, if there's ever an age that needed to bounce back from stress. Most of the time we can't even bounce back, much less from stress. Only bounce we know is when we fell, and we bounce on our back when we fell flat of our back. That's our bounce back. Which is a shame. I said it's a shame. And then we're wondering why God don't do it. And God said, I gave you a brain, you numbskull. I gave you a brain to think with. And you're sending them things all through your body. According to this research, this ability and a person's outlook on life and aging plays an important role in longevity. The perception of aging that we create and the life we build can increase our lifespan. Whoa. So then if I kept thinking in my mind, I'm 56 going on 18. My lifespan will one day catch up with my thought. Oh, my. Notice this, Lord Jesus. Psychologists recommend paying attention to your thought patterns. And when you recognize a negative pattern, work to gradually change your thoughts. Try to restructure the negative sentences that you repeat in your mind to something more positive. Now listen to this. A doctor says this. Meditation or prayer can also help counteract negative thoughts. Glory to God. Oh my. You say that's a bunch of malarkey, is it? Let's jump down a little bit, brothers. Brother Bam says in 1953, healing is not something that you just say, well, I believe it, I believe it. That's all right. If that's the best you can do mentally, you say, well, yes, I see it, I believe it, I accept it. Then you accept it on that basis. Keep saying it over and over. Say it out loud. Say it over and over. Just keep saying, I'm healed, I'm healed. Say it until actually you believe it. And when you believe it, then it's going to take place. Don't have a negative testimony. Whew. Notice in the authority of the word. Now bow your heads if you will. You've got a mental nervousness. The woman asked, Should I? When I believe, I feel like I'm dying all the time. You must believe regardless of anything. This is quite unusual. You know, whenever you get the discernment of somebody now responding back to the discernment. It's a mental nervousness. And the one says, should believe? Should I believe when I feel like I'm dying all the time? And the prophet said, you must believe regardless of anything. You never go to your feeling. You go to your faith. There's where the lacking of it is, sister dear. I want you to be well, see. It's a mental disturbance all the time. You must just keep saying, thank you, Lord, for my healing. Why must she keep saying that? She's rewiring her brain. Now, what if you have a constant diet of 40 years? I'm no good. I'm sorry. I'm rotten. I'm no count. I'll never amount to nothing. Nobody ever likes me. It's always my fault. It's always this, that, the other. Do you realize that atmosphere that you're creating will absolutely guarantee most people won't want to be around you? Because those thoughts that you're projecting, releasing this in your body responds, and you're producing this negative aura all around you. Whew. You must just keep saying, thank you, Lord, for my healing. Thank you, Lord. How are you feeling? Read it. Wonderful. Thank God for my healing. You say she's lying. She's not. The feelings, the depression, the downness is as real as it can be. But this is her testimony. What Satan wants her to accept as her testimony is her downness, her feelings, her rotten attitude. That's what he wants her to be, her confession. I'm sick, I'm weary, I'm down, I'm discouraged. Nobody loves me, and I don't love nobody. That's your testimony. Don't you understand what the psychologist, Dr. William Branham, was doing? Trying to get this woman to see and separate her feelings from her testimony. Those of you that are fighting addictions and smoking or drinking or whatever, don't let that be your testimony. Your testimony is I'm healed. I'm delivered by the power of God. Lord Jesus, how are you feeling? Wonderful. Thank God for my healing. And just keep on like that, and you'll get well. See what I mean? There's where you climb. Over the riffles, it's a battle. And you've got to fight, for you have victory. Sometimes evil spirits want to hold on, and it's left to the people's face. They have to leave in the presence, that's true. But then when they get away, they'll return. You see, many of them demons would leave. What's he trying to do, Brother Skip? Help these people maintain and keep their healing. In the presence of that angel, I guarantee you, the devil scattered like I don't know what. But they knew that angel wasn't with this woman. So they leave while she's in the presence of that angel and that prophet of God. And then as soon as she goes back out to the car, that little pain come back again. And then there would be her testimony. Oh, I thought I was healed. I thought I was better. Uh-huh. Here she goes. Whew. Let's stand. You have something in your body called neuropeptides. It's actually called the molecules of emotions. Your cells feel the way you do. Your thoughts create your reality. What you spend your time thinking about becomes the facts of your life. That's why positive affirmations actually work. They change. Now listen what happens to them. They change the frequencies of the vibrations around your own neuropeptides, allowing cells to function better, your mind to find solutions to your goals, and your whole body-mind system to function optimally. You mean all that comes from thinking? Why is it hard for us to grasp? Everything in this universe comes from thinking. Changing your habitual thought patterns to one of positivity and love to remove energy blockages will allow the electrons around the nucleus of your neuropeptides to send positive, feel-good vibrations of waves and particles throughout your body, mind, being. These vibrations bind to your cell receptors and allow the message. I like to have a spell when I read that. Woo! Glory! Amen. Allow the message to go right into your physical and spiritual. spiritual DNA. A doctor said this. Glory to God. You know, the wonderful thing about it is you don't have to go out here and worry about none of these neuropeptides or neurodetides or none of these other tides. All you got to do is just think positive. I'm His. I'm a child of God. I'm going to heaven. He's going to move for our family. He's going to move in our home. My God shall supply all of your need according to His riches and glory. And all the rest of it will take place on the inside. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's pray together. Oh, Lord, what a wonderful thing you made when you made a human being. How much more is there in us for them to discover? Lord, as we now are in the head age, right up at the intelligence, it's no wonder that the spiritual application of these things couldn't be preached in the days of the feet, in the days of Wesley. The Pentecostals were too concerned about the tongues. But now, Lord, we're up at the mind. Lord Jesus, help us, I pray. We know, Lord, it's not mind over matter. But we take that word of God into our hearts and believe it. Forgive us, Lord. Many of us have been our greatest enemies. Not only in our walk, even in our own health. Change us, Lord God. Help us, I pray. And may we be willing to do the homework. May we be willing, Lord, as it was to go through the spiritual therapy. We've said these old things for many years of our life. I'm no good. I'm no count. All these negative things that are embedded in us. It may be painful. But help the wives. Help the husbands. Help the children. May the fathers, if need be, sit down with the family and do as Brother Branham gave us the example. We need to rededicate our lives to a positive serving God. Our home is filled with negativity. Our home was filled with so much sickness and despair and despondency. Lord, many times I feel it when I walk into saints' homes. It's so heartbreaking. When I walk in there, instead of feeling peace, I feel chaos and disturbance and things out of order. Just things ain't right. And I think, how sad. Yeah, they go to church and they play tapes. They look right on the outside. But there's just something missing in the order of the home. May these men realize they're not given the head position just so they can boss everybody around. What kind of answering will it be for these sons of God if you demand an answer of their home and it's total chaos? How can the wife be expected to do to the children if the men fail? The home will not be in the right order if the men don't set it in order. Lord, not just in televisions and not just in listening to the wrong kind of music and cleaning out the closets and getting rid of this and that and the other, but Lord, cleaning up their attitude, getting rid of the negativity in their life. Then Lord, sitting around and gathering in the front room, as we say, around a little footstool, we're going to pray God will restore order to our home. The same God who moved in Genesis chapter 1 verse 2 when the earth was found in this chaos after its primeval fall. But the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the deep. And in perfect order, He started bringing into view the things which were essential for the earth to be used. You didn't divide the seas first. Amen. You didn't make an atmosphere first. The Spirit of God moved upon the face of the deep and said, let there be light. So light sprung into view, which will further personify all the other acts that will unfold. So, Lord, this is why we must be illuminated by light in our lives, in our homes, in our churches. This is why you let light fall on our faults, so that we can see the faults by the light. And then Ruach Elohim will begin to move upon the face of the deep. And then the atmosphere will come into view, and the waters will be separated into one place. But we first got to see we're wrong, Lord. Show us, Jesus. I repent of my negativity. I've known for a long time I've been too negative, too down on things. Forgive me, Lord. I repent today before your people. Help me, Lord God. Oh, we got to preach against sin and wrong and all that. But help me to balance it out, Lord God. Help me, Father, that I don't preach so many symptoms of the medicine that it defeats the purpose of even preaching the medicine. Help me, I don't preach so many side effects of the medicine that it discourages folks from even wanting to take it. Lord, help us, I pray, Father. And may you men, women, boys, and girls want God to help you replace negativity out of your life. Replace it with the positive things. Oh, friends, it's not mind over matter, but it's God in you taking his word, speaking his word, and believing his word. And let God helping you to live a happier life as a child of God. You think your depression brings glory to God? You think you've been so sad, sisters, and so down that you can never smile? You think that brings honor to him? Do you think you being so depressed, you don't even feel like cleaning your home? You don't feel like combing your hair or cleaning up your children for church? You honestly think that brings glory to the Lord Jesus? It does not. Glory to God. Glory to God. But in the name of Jesus, may the great mighty Elohim go to where you're standing here in this place today. Go to where you're streaming this service. If you're in South Africa, you're in Norway, Canada, wherever you are. May the Holy Ghost may not be limited to these four walls, but may he come through them channels right now where you're streaming and fill your living room. May you and your wife get down there in your front room too. You and your children meet there around your computer. And may the Spirit of God, hallelujah, may you find a refreshing from the presence of the Lord. And may you have a renewing of your mind. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord, which is your reasonable service. And be you not conformed to this world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. Ongoing over and over and over again. In it, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Lord Jesus, I need you today, Father. I'm not ashamed to say I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord God. Help me to be more positive. Help me to be more consecrated than ever been in my life, Lord God. Grant it, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. How many wants to go with me? How many wants to take this mountain before us? Oh, Lord Jesus, I want to be a more positive preacher. I want to be a more positive husband. I want to be a more positive housewife, teenager, whatever you are. Amen. Filling your mouth, your mind, your heart with the word of God to be an encouragement. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord Jesus. Oh, glory to God. I accept it today, Lord. I accept it today, Lord God. May my negative testimony be laid aside today. Father God, may my mouth, my heart, my mind be filled with the positive things of God. I don't want to be a millionaire. I don't want to flee to Cadillacs. I don't want this and that other, but God, I want to be a child of God that's so full of your joy that I've got joy unspeakable and full of glory, that I can be an encouragement. I can be a help to people that are hurting, Lord, in this hour. Grant it, Lord Jesus. Praise God. Before I let you go, would you turn and offer prayer for that person standing there by you. They may have come to church today so down and so low. Physical needs in their body, oppression, financial needs in their home, maybe marital problems. But as one believer to another, do you understand there is a great power in what they call the power of suggestion? You ever been around brothers, or even your husbands and wives that do it as well? And you go to singing a song, and your wife will start singing it. Or she'll sing it, and it'll stick in your mind, and you'll start. You know what that is? The power of suggestion. Oh, glory. I don't want you praying for yourself, but I want you to pray for them. Now, don't get in your mind, well, Brother Donnie prays for them, but listen, that person standing by you today, today may be the very day that God's got determined for their deliverance. Let's pray with all sincerity. Lord Jesus, as these believers have their hands one upon the other, Lord, they can feel for one another. They each one have their own troubles, their own problems at home, on the job, at work. Lord God, may the Holy Ghost, I pray, go from eagle to eagle. We love one another, Lord. We believe we're going to be in eternity together. Many of these sisters, Lord, they carry a great responsibility of raising their children. These brothers have a responsibility of being a godly husband, a godly father. These young people face tests and trials and battles that no other young generation has ever went through. I pray for the young people of our church, Lord God. Strengthen them, Father. They need your courage. They need your help. They need your strength, Lord. Oh, Lamb of God, may the visitation of the Holy Ghost so saturate our souls today. Lord God, I pray not only for our souls, but for our minds, our thoughts, our spirits. May we gird up the loins of our mind. Oh, grant it, Lord, that we can think different, that we can act different, that we can be different, Lord God. Grant it, Lord Jesus. Grant it, Lord Jesus. Fill my mind with the good things of God. May out of the heart my treasure chest laid up. May it come out of there with things that are old, things that are new, things that are positive, things that are creative. Grant it, Lord God. We love you, Lord Jesus. We love you, Lord Jesus. We love you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. How many believes with me today? Look at me. Let me tell you one more thing before we go. Do you realize these doctors and these people that have broke into this realm, they say one of the most sure things to change your life around from negativity and thinking about yourself is reaching out and helping others and getting your thoughts off of your troubles and off of your situation and reaching out and helping others and have a social infrastructure around you of people who love you and do not stay at home by yourself. And I thought, boy, they could tell message folks a few things, and I read that. Don't you see why when you get down and gloomy and sick, Satan don't want you to go to church? He wants you to stay home. He wants you to feel sorry for yourself. But we're not going to do it, aren't we? I said we're not going to do it. And we're not going to live in a little world to ourselves. We want to reach out to others. Praise be to God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You love him. You appreciate his grace. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise be to God. God bless you, saints. I love you in the Lord. I hope I didn't confuse you on all this stuff. Hope it was simple enough that you could make a little bit out of it and be able to take it home with you. Change your lives. There's one thing I want for you. The best. I want the best of everything God wants for you. I want you to have everything financially that God can trust you with. I want you to have your health. I want you to be happy. I want you to have joy in your home. Peace in your walk with God. That's what I want for you. I want you to be filled with the power of God. I want you to be filled with revelation. I want you to have absolutely everything that God's got in your account. That's all. That's what I want for you as your pastor, as your shepherd. This is what I want for you. I'm not interested in you having things of the world and all that sort of thing. I'm not interested in having your things. But I want you to have everything God wants for you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord Jesus. Let's sing together, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. And we'll go. Go in the fear of God. May God be with you. Lord willing, Wednesday night, we'll be looking back again in the book of Genesis. Oh, I believe we're going to have some wonderful things. Let's sing together. Amazing grace, how sweet the